Hello, everyone, and welcome to Slash Film Daily for June 21st, 2018. On today's episode, we're going to be talking about the latest TV and film news. This is Slash Film senior writer Ben Pearson, and joining me today are Slash Film writers Hoai-Tran
Hey, everyone.
And Chris Evangelista.
Hello.
All right, guys. So I think it's probably a good idea for us to start off today's episode by providing a little bit of an update, albeit a confusing one, to a story that we talked about on the show yesterday, which is yesterday we talked about how Lucasfilm was reportedly putting all of their Star Wars story spinoff movies on hold. But it seems now like that is kind of being called into question. So what happened is ABC News spoke with Lucasfilm, and they're now reporting that yesterday's story was, quote, premature and speculative, and that multiple non-trilogy movies are still in the works. So just to be clear, for anybody who maybe didn't listen to yesterday's episode, the Star Wars movies, the trilogy that's being overseen by Rian Johnson, who directed The Last Jedi, and that new trilogy is supposed to deal with characters that we've never seen or heard from before in the Star Wars universe, that is still on. And another series of movies from David Benioff and D.B. Weiss, who are the creators of HBO's Game of Thrones, that is also still on. So that's what we talked about yesterday. But yesterday's report said that, you know, movies like the Obi-Wan film and the, maybe if a Yoda movie was in the works, or like Boba Fett, those sort of not officially announced, but movies that were basically rumbled about as in terms of like being in development, that those movies aren't happening. But this new update says that Lucasfilm told ABC News that there are still multiple Star Wars films currently in development that have not been officially announced, and those projects are moving forward separate from the ones that I just mentioned with Rian Johnson and Benioff and Weiss. So there are a few possibilities. I think that maybe Collider's report yesterday was inaccurate, or that this move is sort of like damage control for the people at Disney who are like seeing all of this potentially, you know, everybody talking about this yesterday and trying to like get a hold of the story and then control the narrative while they still can. And I don't know. Do you guys have any thoughts about what might have gone wrong here or what the truth could be? Chris, have you been able to ascertain anything from any of this?
I think it's safe to say that Lucasfilm and Disney are, you know, exploring new options and they're reconsidering a few things, but I don't want to throw anyone under the bus, but I feel like maybe yesterday's big story was maybe prematurely released, and now maybe Lucasfilm is scrambling to set the record straight. I mean, or at the same time, maybe it was accurate and Lucasfilm is just saying this to save face. I really don't know. I mean, like I said, it's safe to say that something's going on, but I think it's almost impossible for us to ever really know unless we literally like worked for Lucasfilm.
Yeah, and Collider has had a pretty good track record, so I'm sure they heard something. I don't know if something may have gotten lost in translation, and I'm actually just now reading in our Slack channel, Peter Serretta, the editor-in-chief of SlashFilm.com, just shared this story from a website called Making Star Wars, and they sort of hint that the movie that was theoretically in the works was supposed to be along the lines of like a Mos Eisley Cantina spaceport movie that was not that wasn't an official title, but crew members were theoretically supposed to be working on this film, and then that is one of the ones that ended up being canned or postponed. So that's an interesting wrinkle, because we had never heard anything about that kind of film being developed, and this is still, I guess, early on, and we're still trying to figure out, separate fact from fiction here, but I just wanted to give you guys this information as we were getting it, so we'll look into that and see if it's worth actually writing about. But HT, do you have any thoughts about any of this?
I wonder if maybe Collider's report was incomplete. Maybe they heard early reports, but not what was actually happening, the most updated version of it, or perhaps just got distorted through the grapevine. It sounds like the sources are all not really on the same page, and now that that story came out, Lucasfilm is, like you said, kind of scrambling to get everyone on that same page.
Yeah, we'll have to wait and see. I'm sure, you know, the truth will rise up sometime very soon. But in the meantime, let's talk about another update to, or I guess a follow-up story to another story that we talked about yesterday, which was MoviePass, and we talked yesterday about how AMC Theaters had just launched their own movie theater subscription, like ticket subscription plan to compete directly with MoviePass. And now MoviePass has responded, but in sort of an unusual way. HT, what's going on?
Well, isn't everything MoviePass do is an unusual strategy? Anyways, welcome back to MoviePass Daily, in which we update you on the most recent MoviePass feature. They are going to be introducing surge pricing for certain popular movies. So starting in July, monthly MoviePass subscribers will have to pay $2 or higher for certain titles and showtimes that are in higher demand. This doesn't apply to you if you are an annual MoviePass subscriber, but it will apply to only the monthly MoviePass subscribers. So if you want to see a movie on opening weekend, or if it's a big blockbuster like Star Wars or a Marvel movie, then it will likely be a little higher. It employs the same strategy that rideshare apps like Uber or Lyft use. So it sounds like a won't be a very popular feature, because the $10 a month price was the biggest draw for MoviePass, and they're kind of screwing themselves over by introducing something that will add a twist to people who don't expect it, at least unless they're listening to this daily podcast about MoviePass. So but they do have a few new features that will maybe balance things out. One includes being able to add a ticket purchase for your friend, as well as options to buy IMAX and 3D movies, although those will also be subject to surge pricing.
Okay, well, it seems like they're trying to do something, I guess, to sort of offset a little bit of that, the bad taste that the surge pricing might leave in people's mouths. But Chris, I imagine you probably don't have too many thoughts on this, since you're not a MoviePass subscriber, right? Or am I wrong? Do you have a scalding hot take on this?
I'm just tired of the MoviePass wars, as I call them. I'd like this to just come to an end. It seems like every day there's a new MoviePass story. It's getting a little exhausting.
Yeah, there's actually two today, and we'll talk about the second one in just a second. But before we get to that, HT, you are a MoviePass subscriber. Does this surge pricing make you wary? Is this something that is going to make you not renew your subscription with them?
So I actually have an annual subscription, so okay. It won't apply to me. But yeah, it's not a good move on MoviePass's part. Once my annual subscription runs out, I will probably just abandon ship and go to that AMC deal. Although I do like the fact that IMAX and 3D are being added, as well as the inclusion of Landmark theaters.
Yeah. So the other MoviePass-related thing is their troubles have continued, and a new report says that they might need more than $1.2 billion in additional capital to become profitable. So we've talked a lot about how their, I guess, business model is not necessarily sustainable in the long term. There's a lot of, analysts and financial people who are really, putting this company under close watch and trying to figure out what the hell is going on with them. But the latest is that Helios and Matheson Analytics, which is the parent company of MoviePass, has just launched a $164 million bond sale in an attempt to basically stay alive as a company, because according to Variety, in October, their stock was trading at $38.86 a share. But on Wednesday of this week, it closed at just over 33 cents a share. So that's a huge price drop. And they're trying to get the share price above $1 so it is not delisted from the NASDAQ. And I don't know much about stocks, but being delisted from the NASDAQ sounds like a bad thing if you're a company who's trying to make it big out there. So in addition to all of this, Business Insider has a report that says that MoviePass's monthly losses were listed at $40 million in May, which was last month, and it might actually go up as much to $45 million for this month. So, yeah, I mean, all of this basically is pointing to the fact that MoviePass is struggling financially. This is something we've known for a while, but I don't know if we've known to this degree that they're that they need some significant help. So Helios and Matheson filed a report with the Securities and Exchange Commission this week saying that they will require a significant amount of additional capital for MoviePass that might exceed $1.2 billion to become a profitable company and achieve the economy of scale in the movie industry that we're expecting. So yes, I think all of this, again, I'm not like a financial expert, so I can't parse all of the details, but in broad strokes, I think this is probably pointing to MoviePass is days being numbered, and I don't know how much longer they're going to be able to stay afloat. They may be able to stretch it out for another year or something, but this is not exactly what, you know, exciting and confidence building news that you would want to hear from a company like this. So we actually have in this article that I wrote some ways for MoviePass to make $1.2 billion, and they're all jokes and ridiculous. So you can check that out in the show notes. Let's move on. HT, tell us about another Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie that's in the works.
So only 2 years after the last Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles movie came out in theaters, Paramount is developing a new version. They've hired screenwriter Andrew Dodge to pen the latest adventure for the infamous, or I guess famous, turtles Raphael, Leonardo, Donatello, and Michelangelo. And it will be developed by Platinum Dunes, who developed A Quiet Place, which is a big hit for Paramount, as well as producers Andrew Form, Brad Fuller, and Michael Bay, who are the same team behind the 2014 and 2016 Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. I was actually not aware that there was a 2016 sequel, but apparently it was not quite that big of a hit, and now they're bringing on the same team with a new screenwriter to redevelop that series for the big screen.
So I have not seen that sequel that you're talking about. I think it's called Out of the Shadows. Yes. Chris, did you see it for any of the streaming columns or anything that you've written?
No, I will not watch this. I'm sorry, but no.
Okay, so I grew up loving the Ninja Turtles. We may have talked about this on an old episode of this podcast, but HT, you're a bit younger than me, and I think I was in like that sweet spot age range for the Ninja Turtles in like the late 80s, early 90s. Did you and your contemporaries have much of a relationship to the Ninja Turtles growing up?
I did, actually. I watched the animated series quite a bit, although they don't hold such a big place in my heart like the Power Rangers TV show did, but I still remember it fondly, only vaguely though. But I was a sort of like a casual fan of Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and would watch a few episodes, but I was pretty young, so I didn't really flock to see the movie despite being like vaguely interested, just because it looked pretty terrible and very Michael Bay-ized.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I saw Bad Words and thought that movie was, like, you know, kind of funny, not bad. It's not necessarily something where I was like, the screenwriter for this, you know what he should do? The next Ninja Turtles movie. Like, there's not much there to sort of draw that particular line. And the idea that the same producers are on board here just sort of makes me feel like this is going to be more the same. But I don't know. We'll have to keep our eye on this and see if maybe it's like a Bumblebee Transformers sort of situation where they try to, like, totally change the entire tone of everything. Thing and the look of everything. So we'll see. All right, so moving from Ninja Turtles to It Chapter 2, Chris, tell us about the surprising new addition to this film's cast.
Yes, so Xavier Dolan, who's he's a French-Canadian filmmaker. He made a film called Tom at the Farm and a film called Mommy. He's made several films, and he's also an actor, and I was not expecting this at all, but he has joined the cast of It 2. He's playing a character from Stephen King's book. The character, basically, it kicks off the adult section of the book, how, you know, part of the book is about the characters as kids, and part of them is about adults, and this character's, I'm hesitant to say too much because I don't want to give spoilers for the movie, but something happens to this character that kicks off, you know, the adult section of the story. And I just was not expecting this because he's not exactly a big name, but he's just someone I didn't expect to be in this film. But it's kind of cool. Yeah, he's friends with Jessica Chastain. She was supposed to appear in his upcoming movie, The Death and Life of John F. Donovan, but he had to cut her scene for story reasons. But in addition to that, last year when the first It came out, he actually went on social media and said that it was, I'm quoting, his favorite film of this century. So he really loved the first It, and I guess that paid off because now he's in the sequel.
That's pretty cool. So I have also read this book, and yeah, I'm hesitant to accidentally spoil anything for anyone, so I'll try to be as vague as possible. But Chris, you were mentioning in our Slack channel earlier that the fact that this character is being included is an encouraging thing for you, right, in this movie?
It is, because this definitely will distance the film from the 1990 miniseries, which is, you know, I love the miniseries, but... this character wasn't featured at all in the miniseries. You know, his storyline wasn't in the miniseries at all. So the fact that he's in this movie indicates that they're taking this film in a different direction than the miniseries, and in a closer direction to Stephen King's book. So that's kind of exciting to me.
Cool. All right, so let's move on to Kick-Ass 3. This movie has been in talks for a long time, and it still, I don't think, has an official green light. But if it does end up happening, Chloe Grace Moretz, who played Hit Girl in the original Kick-Ass and in 2013's Kick-Ass 2, will not be reprising her role. So Moretz was recently on a panel discussion at a film festival, and the conversation turned to whether or not she would be interested in playing the role of Hit Girl again. And like I said, despite tons of talks over the years of maybe a Kick-Ass 3 happening, I think Matthew Vaughn, the director of the first Kick-Ass, recently announced plans to reboot Kick-Ass into a whole different movie with a black female lead, which is sort of following in line with what's going on in Mark Millar's comics. Moretz said that she's not interested in coming back. She said, "I love the franchise. I think the first movie was really, really special. I wish the second one had been handled in a little bit of a different way, because I think we were all kind of looking forward to something a little different than what happened with it all. As much as I love the character of Hit Girl, I think she lives and survives in Kick-Ass, the first movie, and I kind of want to keep her there. I kind of want to keep everyone's mind in Kick-Ass, so I don't think there will be a Kick-Ass 3, at least I don't think with Hit Girl in it." So, that sounds pretty definitive, and I think it means that she didn't necessarily have a great experience on Kick-Ass 2, which had a different director. I think Jeff Wadlow directed that film, and I don't know if you guys remember Kick-Ass 2 or even saw that movie, but I liked the first Kick-Ass a decent amount when I came out in 2010, and the second one, man, that is just a grimy, nasty piece of comic book movie. I don't know, it's one of the, like, the most bleak superhero movies I think that exists out there. There's like a decapitation, an attempted rape. There's like, this movie would have spawned a billion think pieces if it came out in theaters today. So it's not surprising that she didn't necessarily have a great experience on this movie, because it was just relentlessly unpleasant in my memory. Did either of you see Kick-Ass 2? Do you guys have any memories of that film?
Yeah, I saw it, and I'm on the same page as you, Ben. I remember liking Kick-Ass 1 and then being shocked at how brutal and just nihilistic Kick-Ass 2 was. And, which is really funny, because it also had that subplot with Hit Girl, which was like a coming-of-age high school comedy. And mm-hmm. then on the other side is like, who was the villain in that?
I think it was Christopher Mintz-Plasse.
Oh, it was Jim Carrey.
Jim Carrey was like, he was like the leader of like the Kick-Ass versus version of like a Justice League kind of thing.
Yeah, it was bad. I did not like it. I liked all of Hit Girl's scenes though, but it was just very atonal and just very brutal and unpleasant to watch.
Chris, are you going to talk us off the ledge here? Was Kick-Ass 2 any good? Did you see
that? I never saw it. I did not like the first Kick-Ass. I'm one of those weirdos who does not like Matthew Vaughn's movies. I know people seem to love him, but I kind of just don't care for his movies. So I didn't bother seeing Kick-Ass 2 after seeing Kick-Ass 1.
Okay, well, yeah, I thought it was also worth mentioning that Mark Millar, who is also a guy who loves to talk about all sorts of different projects, so anything he says is not necessarily like, should not necessarily be held in super high esteem, because he says a lot of stuff that sometimes never actually pans out. But in any case, he wants Tessa Thompson to play the starring role of Patience Lee, who is that new female version of Kick-Ass I mentioned earlier. So that's his sort of like pie in the sky dream choice to play the role. And I think on social media, she said that she was interested, but you know, who knows how those conversations might pan out. So we may be hearing about another Kick-Ass movie, but it sounds like Chloe Moretz's Hit Girl will not be in it if that actually happens. So we'll keep you guys posted. Let's move on to Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. The box office tracking is in on this film. Chris, what's it looking like?
It's looking good. It's not going to be as big of a hit as the previous Jurassic World, which I think surprised everyone by just becoming this monstrous hit. It's actually the I think it's the fifth biggest box office hit in history, that film, somehow. And this film, it's on track to a 130 to 140 million domestic opening when it opens this weekend. But it's also worth noting that the film has already opened overseas, and it's taken in 372 million overseas already. So when all is said and done, this is going to be another big Jurassic hit.
So, Chris, have you had a chance to see a screening of this movie yet?
I didn't. I was supposed to go this week, and the screening location was an hour away. And I said, you know what? I don't feel like driving an hour for this movie.
I saw you tweeting about that. I was like, I wonder what movie that is.
So I'm probably going to go see it like tomorrow morning or over the weekend or something.
HG, have you seen a screening yet?
I have not. I would see a screening of it. I'm not too eager to pay for it, but because I did not like the first Jurassic World. But we'll see. Maybe I'll be proven wrong.
Yeah, I don't want to get into a whole thing here, but I saw a screening earlier this week, and I think longtime listeners of the show will know that I've defended Jurassic World a little bit, the original one, in the past. I think that movie's kind of fun, and I did not have a good time with Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. I was so disappointed in pretty much every aspect of it. So maybe we can talk about that once the movie actually comes out. But I was not a fan of this movie, and I'm disappointed that... I'm frankly disappointed in anyone who put their names on this movie, because it's really like it sort of flies in the face of everything that the original Jurassic World or the Jurassic Park stands for. It's really bad. At one point, Ian Malcolm, I actually have my notes right here. I wrote down there's one point where Jeff Goldblum's character says, how many times must this point be made at the end of the movie? And I'm like, yes, exactly. Why are you still making Jurassic World movies? It's a concept that really only worked once, even though, like I said, I sort of had fun with the first Jurassic World. But I think the world would be a better place if they had just stopped after the first Jurassic Park. But again, yeah, that's a teaser for another conversation to come, I'm sure. Finally, last item of the day. HT, Bond Watch is on again. What is the latest update in the James Bond universe?
So the latest update is that Mark Strong may be starring in James Bond 25. And if you're not surprised by this news, it's because he's like the perfect match for this franchise. I'm actually more surprised that he hasn't already been in a Bond movie. But this comes from an Instagram video from Mark Strong's personal trainer, Giacomo Farci, who posted a video of Mark Strong working out and had added some hashtags, James Bond, Bond 25, and 007. That Instagram video has now been removed, so it seems like it's indicating that Strong will be appearing in the 25th 007 adventure. We're not sure yet whether he'll be playing a villain or whether he'll be playing a supporting character, but it seems from his career sort of trend that he will be playing a Bond villain in this case.
So, Chris, you found this photo of Daniel Craig and Mark Strong together in what was that from again?
It's some BBC show called like Our Friend in the North or something like
Our
that.
Our Friends in the North. Yeah, it's from the 90s. And I thought it was like a period piece, but apparently it's in modern day, at least in the 90s. I don't remember anyone having hair like that in the 90s.
My God, Daniel Craig in this photo. Like, people, you should definitely click on this link in our show notes and look at this photo, because it looks like Daniel Craig is doing an audition to play the Beast in a live-action Beauty and the Beast movie or something. It's totally nuts. These guys, their hair is out of control. So I guess just... Aisha, you sort of mentioned that Mark Strong, obviously super well known for playing villains. Chris, do you think he's, even though he's an obvious choice, do you think it's a good choice for Mark Strong to play a Bond villain?
I mean, he's a good actor. I like Mark Strong, but it is kind of like cliche at this point that he would end up being a Bond. He just seems like someone who was destined to be a Bond villain. And I mean, he was already in like the Kingsman film, so he already has that sort of, you know, spy movie cred already. It's very strange. I mean, I think it would actually be refreshing if he ended up playing a good character, but I don't know if that'll happen.
Yeah, that would be awesome. Because, I mean, like, the they cast the guy who played Moriarty in Sherlock. And the actor's name escapes me at this moment. But I'm talking about Inspector. And it was so obvious from the first moment that he was on screen that this was a bad guy. And then, you know, there's a late act twist where it's like, oh, it's this big reveal that he was a bad guy all along. It was like, yeah, no kidding. You cast the bad guy who looks, you know,
Jared Harris, right?
Jared Harris was in... No,
you're thinking of Sherlock Holmes.
Oh, you're talking about the BBC miniseries.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Sherlock,
Andrew Scott.
Yes, Andrew Scott. Yeah, that's it. Thank you for the assist. Yeah, Andrew Scott. I mean, he looks like the most Weasley character of all time, and you try to make it out to be a good guy. And I just hope that they learned a lesson from that. And yes, maybe they cast Mark Strong and then just play him against type where they don't actually fall into the cliche, as you said. That would be a great improvement. And maybe who's directing? Danny Boyle. Maybe he will have the wherewithal to do something like that and actually make an interesting casting decision. I don't know. I feel like with Danny Boyle on the table here, anything is an option. It's not necessarily, we're not necessarily in for just a repeat of what we've seen before. This could be an opportunity for the Bond franchise to really do something new and fresh. So I'm excited about it. We'll see what happens and what role Mark Strong will play, if any. Maybe his trainer just got him fired from the movie. I don't know. We'll see about that. But before we go, where can people find more of your work online? HT, let's start with you.
You can find me every day at slashfilm.com, and I'm on Twitter at htranbuie.
Chris?
I'm also at slashfilm.com, and I'm on Twitter at cevangelista413.
You can find me at Slashfilm as well. You can find me on Twitter at Ben Pears, and you can find more about all of the stories we mentioned on today's show at slashfilm.com and linked in the show notes of this episode. Slashfilm Daily, this podcast, is published every weekday, bringing you the most exciting news from the world of movies and TV, as well as deeper dives into the great features you can find at slashfilm.com. You can subscribe to Slashfilm Daily on iTunes, Google Play, Overcast, Spotify, all the popular podcast apps, and please feel free to send your feedback, questions, comments, and concerns to us at peter@slashfilm.com. Make sure to leave your name and general geographic location in case we mention your email on the air. Don't forget to rate and review the podcast on iTunes. Tell your friends about the show and spread the word any way you can. Thanks for listening, everybody. We'll see you tomorrow.